Macmillan Australia Audio and Belinda present this unabridged recording of A Doctor in Africa, the Australian surgeon changing lives of women in Africa, written by Andrew Browning and read by Jeremy Stanford. I dedicate this book to all the women who have suffered a fistula when they never should have, given it is so easily prevented, if only we cared enough to help. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. Micah, chapter 6, verse 8. Preface by HRH, the Princess Royal, Princess Anne. There are few more important times in a woman's life than the time she gives birth to a child. For too many women in the world, childbirth can have devastating consequences, death or complications leading to a life of isolation and shame. I have seen firsthand the gift of healing given back to some of the poorest women in the world who suffer from fistula after childbirth. With fistula eradicated in the Western world, little is known about this debilitating condition beyond the shores of Africa and other developing nations. A Doctor in Africa lifts the lid on the silent shame of fistula injuries. I met Dr. Browning in Ethiopia in 2002 on my second visit to Dr. Catherine Hamlin's fistula hospital. He has since started his own fistula charity to take the work started by Dr. Hamlin and spread it over the rest of Africa and also the world. In 2019, the charity's hospitals provided the safe delivery of more than 15,000 babies at no cost to the mothers, and slightly less in 2020 due to a drop in funding related to COVID-19. I have also recently become patron of Dame Anne Gloag's Fistula Charity, based in the UK and working in Africa. I applaud the work of Dr. Browning and his peers to treat this condition. A Doctor in Africa is as uplifting as it is tragic, but in the end, leaves you with a sense of hope. Foreword by Her Excellency, Mrs. Linda Hurley. I was delighted to accept the Barbara May Foundation's invitation to write the foreword to A Doctor in Africa. The foundation was established in honour of the author's grandmother and provides life-saving maternal health care in Africa. A Doctor in Africa is an autobiography by Dr. Andrew Browning, AM, that highlights in meticulous detail the important work of the foundation and varied experiences on the continent. Dr. Browning has spent 17 years in Africa, operating on more than 7,000 women suffering from obstetric fistulas, a debilitating condition caused by obstructed childbirth. The World Health Organization estimates that between 50,000 and 100,000 women worldwide are affected by this condition each year. While the subject matter of this book is confronting and contains some disturbing stories, it is ultimately an uplifting read, a triumph of one man's determination, no matter the obstacles, to improve the lives of fellow human beings. Dr. Browning, who was appointed a member of the Order of Australia in 2019 for services to the medical profession in developing countries, has helped transform the lives of thousands of women. I cannot imagine the pain and suffering these women have gone through. Joy's story, at the start of the book, is both heart-wrenching and inspiring,
while the miracle of Missae
will warm the cockles of the heart. The chapter Reflections contains a lovely description of a conversation over lunch in late 2019 between Dr. Browning and his then frail mentor, the late Dr. Catherine Hamlin, AC, a remarkable Australian who dedicated her entire adult life to caring for Ethiopian women suffering birth injuries. I commend all involved in the production of A Doctor in Africa. It is an absorbing read and a comprehensive account of Dr. Browning's life and career thus far. I congratulate Dr. Browning for instilling hope and bringing joy to the lives of many women around the world. Introduction. Joy's Hope. I had arrived in my creaking old Land Cruiser after struggling through the gears of the aging gearbox along roads that tested its four-wheel drive capability. It was just after dawn in the small rural northern Tanzanian hospital I was working at. As I greeted the staff, everyone smiled, dressed in incredibly crisp white doctor's coats and white nurses' uniforms, contrasting with their dark skin. A couple of patients had arrived overnight and were eager to be seen. They were typical of many of my patients squatting nervously on the floor outside the examination room, dressed in clothes soaked in urine, too ashamed of their smell and appearance to raise their heads to greet me. Habari Yasabui, I offered as I made my way to the chapel for the morning service with the staff. A weak smile and a faint Nzuri was the reply. No one lifted their heads. As the chapel service began, farmers were laughing as they dug in the field outside. The sound of their thud, thud of hoe meeting the ground went in time with the singing in the chapel. The early morning sun poured golden through the hospital. Standing there with all my friends and colleagues who had made me so welcome in a country that wasn't my own, it felt good to be alive. Back in the ward, Joy was the first lady for me to examine. Having just come from morning prayers with the staff, led by the chaplain, the beautiful sound of voices singing, as only Africans can, rang in my ears. I took the history with the help of Agnes, a very capable nurse, who translated for me. How old are you? Joy was 18 years old. She'd had a few periods, become married, and then, as is so often the case, she quickly became pregnant. She was from a village at least 200 kilometres from our hospital. When it came time to have her baby, Joy did what everyone else in her village did and stayed in her mother-in-law's home to deliver. In one of the most momentous times in a woman's life, she would labour in the smoke-filled dark hut made of mud mixed with straw, built over a frame of wooden poles and a thatched roof. Most women in labour deliver in less than a day, but Joy strained in labour for 2 days. After 48 hours of relentless, agonising pain, she still hadn't delivered. She was weak from the labour pains, continually moving to try and get some relief from the pain, felt especially in her back. In remote villages, it is incredibly difficult to get help, but a traditional birth attendant was called, an unschooled lady, a resident of the village whose most crucial qualification was that she had delivered her own babies in the past and did quite well. She saw Joy, observed her for some time, tried a few things, and then told her that she couldn't deliver normally and she would have to go to hospital. The nearest one was 100 kilometres away. There were no roads and no communication, so her husband raced to get someone with a motorbike, and he, her father, and Joy all crowded onto one motorbike, driving along bumpy tracks to a dirt road, and then onto the hospital. The journey was 4 hours, and it was agony. Joy's contractions coming again and again in torturous waves. Another day had passed. Joy was unconscious when she arrived at the hospital. Her father had to carry her, barely alive, to see the doctor. She awoke 2 days later with searing pain across her abdomen and racking her entire body. The doctors had taken her to theatre and performed a caesarean to save her life. Her baby had already died before being born. It took a couple of days before Joy started to gain strength, began to talk, and slowly became aware of her surroundings. She had tubes in her arm, bladder, and abdomen. She was afraid and in pain. Aghast, Joy found she was sitting in a pool of urine and feces and called her father, who helped get her clean. But the offensive-smelling urine and feces kept coming. As soon as she was clean, more came. The doctors saw her and bowed and shook their heads. They muttered the word I would use a lot in my career, fistula, and they said they couldn't help her. After a couple of weeks, still smelling badly, Joy went home, leaking, still weak, but slowly gaining strength. Realizing that she was leaking and not getting better, her husband soon left her. Joy couldn't work and probably would never be able to have children. To a woman of her tribe, there is nothing more shameful than not being able to bear children. Humiliated and unwilling to go out and mix with people in the market, church, or village, she hid herself away in her parents' hut, and later, a separate hut that her parents built for her, as her smell was so bad. Joy lived alone in that hut for 18 months. No one came to see her, and she was too ashamed to meet others.
Dark depression set in,
and many times she thought of taking her own life. One day, our outreach workers from the hospital came and taught people in the marketplace of her village about fistulas. They explained what a fistula was to the gathered crowd of people and how it could be helped, and asked if they knew anyone with this condition. After the crowd dispersed, Joy's father came and spoke with Lucas, whispering that his daughter Joy was like this. Even after 18 months, her father could not hide his embarrassment and shame. Lucas went with him to Joy's hut and was able to bring her to our hospital the following day, the day before I first met her, and Nurse Agnes helped me by translating. Joy sat tearfully before me. Urine had already pooled in the plastic chair as she recalled her story. I examined her and said I thought she could be cured. She was still weak, and after 18 months alone inside a tiny hut, Joy couldn't walk properly. But she was strong enough to be operated on, so we scheduled her surgery for 2 days' time. All my patients that day were the same. Same stories of lost babies, leaking and shame, isolation, loneliness and depression. All were admitted and given hope. Joy was understandably apprehensive when we took her to theatre. Her only experience of a hospital was the caesarean operation for her dead baby, and she ended up leaking urine and feces. Agnes and I held her hand and prayed with her. She smiled and seemed comforted. The operation was fairly straightforward by the standard of most fistula operations. Joy was fed intravenous fluids for a while and had tubes in her bladder for 10 days afterwards. Being dry for the first time in a year and a half, her confidence grew. She smiled, sat upright, greeted us each morning with increasing hope and enthusiasm, and walked proudly around the hospital with the other fistula patients, talking, giggling, and gaining strength. But the big test was to come. Would she begin to leak again as soon as the catheters were removed? The day came to remove her rubber catheter tubing from her bladder and truly see if the operation had worked. We removed it, and she was dry, whole, beaming, still some tears, but this time tears of joy. After the long obstructed labour ending in a stillborn baby and fistula, Joy was isolated, ashamed, childless, embarrassed, and divorced. Now she was cured, filled with life and gratitude, eager to return home to her family. Before, she had no future beyond that small, solitary, smelly hut. Now, she had hope. My name is Andrew Browning, and Joy's story is very familiar to me. As an Australian doctor in Africa, I have met more than 12,000 Joys who have had fistulas following obstructed childbirth, and I've personally operated on more than 7,000 women just like her, and still counting. I have been blessed to be given the medical skills to help some of the 2 million women around the world suffering from this most debilitating of conditions. In the so-called developed world, fistulas are rarely, if ever, seen by doctors because women can get to hospitals and have an operation, a caesarean section, if they have obstructed childbirth. Obstruction means that the baby is getting stuck in labour and is not coming out. It may be caused by a small or ill-shaped pelvis, or the baby is too big or in an awkward position, so it simply gets stuck during delivery. In the most severe cases, the baby cannot fit through no matter how hard the uterus contracts trying to push it out. It's common, happening to some degree in about 5% of pregnancies all around the world. In places like Europe, the UK, America, Australia, and others with widespread and available obstetric care, the obstructed baby is delivered by caesarean section, where the abdominal incision is made and the baby is simply lifted free. Then mum goes home with her child in a few days. During my obstetrics training in Sydney in the late 1990s, caesareans were commonplace, perhaps too common. The procedure has been used for centuries, but only widely used since the early 1900s. It saves lives and prevents obstetric fistula, as long as women can get to a hospital in good time to deliver safely. But sadly, in places like rural Africa and Southeast Asia, where women can't easily get to a hospital to deliver their baby, obstructed birth resulting in obstetric fistula and all its complications is still occurring. Women who have no help can often labour for 3, 5, 7, or even 10 days. Their babies almost always die, and so does most of the tissue in the pelvis. If they survive the ordeal, and many don't, they remain with massive tissue loss in their pelvis. The mother's tissues are compressed by the baby's head being pushed against her bones. The tissues die over broad areas, come away, and fistulas form. A fistula is a hole between the bladder and the vagina, and sometimes the rectum and the vagina as well. Injuries can be so severe that the whole urethra, the tube carrying the urine from the bladder to the outside world, is destroyed. Sometimes the whole bladder, rectum, anus, vagina, uterus, and pelvic muscles are all destroyed. Nothing is left, simply because the mother couldn't get to a hospital to deliver her baby. But in severe cases of obstructed labour, both mother and child die. In Australia, 1 in 16,000 women die from complications in pregnancy. In sub-Saharan Africa, south of the Sahara Desert in Africa, 1 in every 37 women dies from complications during pregnancy. In one area where we work, the figure is 1 in 12. Around the world, a staggering 810 women die every day from complications in pregnancy. This is the official figure, but the real figure is likely to be higher. Many more get injuries. If she survives an obstructed labour, a woman has a high chance of developing a feared obstetric fistula, where she is left with malodorous urine and or feces leaking from her body for the rest of her life. There are no effective government social welfare systems throughout most of the world. The only system is family and community, which is perhaps the strongest of all systems. However, with a fistula, leaking and smelling, even the family support network can break down. A fistula patient is often left ostracized and neglected, and many attempt suicide in a desperate attempt to get rid of this horrid suffering. We have no idea how many succeed. In Joy's case, as with all the others, her fistula was a direct result of a lack of easy access to health facilities and surgeons trained in caesarean sections. I first arrived in Africa nearly 3 decades ago as an enthusiastic young medical student. I was naive but impressed by the toughness and resilience of the people, especially the women. Despite the many beauties of Africa and wonderful things about the cultures, the maternal health system was lacking. Death, difficulties in childbirth, fistula, and isolation were all too real, and the women faced those risks with incredible bravery. Today, rays of hope are slowly stretching across the continent as more hospitals are built and health professionals trained so that women don't have to deliver their child, fearing death or injury as they used to. What happens to women like Joy in Africa is a tragedy, and it saddens me greatly. But with the work of a growing number of dedicated nurses and doctors in Africa and Southeast Asia, women's healthcare is improving as hope spreads. I'm proud to be part of their story. Chapter 1. Inspired. When I was just 6, attending Sunday school at St. Jude's Anglican Church, Bowral, We were visited by a missionary nurse from Tanzania. Her name was Dot Thompson, and she worked with the Church Missionary Society. As I sat, cross-legged at her feet, looking up at her with wide eyes, I was captivated by her stories and the emotion that she exuded as she spoke passionately about her life and work in Africa. She excited me with stories of a missionary father and son who were forced to hide in a tree to escape from hungry lions, stories of wild, free places, different people and different languages. As a kindergarten-age child, I was sure hers was a life I wanted to emulate as a missionary, and I decided it would be best to be a doctor. My grandparents on both sides of the family were English. My paternal grandmother, Barbara May Barnes, was orphaned along with her sister Joan at the age of 3 as a result of the Spanish flu pandemic. My paternal grandfather, John Browning, was a restless adventurer going from England to Canada to try his hand at farming, later to Zimbabwe, then called Rhodesia, to work a tobacco farm north of Harare, then Salisbury, and finally to Australia. When the war broke out, his father, a colonel in the British Army, brought him home to fight. My grandfather returned for the war as an officer under Montgomery and moved through North Africa and up through Italy as the Germans retreated. During this time, he married Barbara May, and following the war, they settled in the south of England as dairy farmers and raised 8 children on the land. My father, David, was the eldest child in the family and was driving tractors to work the farm from the age of 6 with blocks of wood tied to his feet so he could reach the pedals. Soon after my father left home to study medicine, my grandfather John decided to immigrate with Barbara and the 7 other children to Australia. My father stayed back in England to continue studying medicine in London. My mother, Daphne, grew up in Chichester, Sussex, England. Daphne trained as a nurse, and while working in the St. Richard's Hospital in Chichester, a cliché doctor-nurse romance blossomed with a young man working as a junior doctor in the hospital, Dr. David Browning. They were married in 1966. As a young doctor, my father answered the call to be a 10-pound pom and moved to Australia to help with the deficit of professionals in the country at the time. Having the rest of his family in Australia no doubt helped him make this decision. Dad became a general practitioner in central north New South Wales, but was interested in specialising in obstetrics and gynaecology. Back in the 1960s, there was no specialist obstetrics medical training offered in Australia, so my parents, with their new young son Paul, moved back to England for further medical study. I was born in 1969 in the southeast of England in a small village called Pembury in County Kent. In 1973, when I was 3, we emigrated to Australia with my older brother Paul and newborn sister Claire. We flew to Singapore, and I recall Claire lying in her bassinet hanging from the ceiling of the aircraft. Not something that is done today. From Singapore, we travelled by boat, stopping in Perth and Melbourne before our final destination in Sydney. After some time in Grafton, we settled to the south of Sydney in the green hills of Bowral in the Southern Highlands. My mother was missing England, so Dad searched for a place to live that might remind her of home. Bowral was the pick. It was a sleepy country town back in the 70s, a wonderful place to grow up. That idyllic life was shattered on the 31st of March, 1978, when I woke up to find a family friend, Mrs. McKenzie, sitting at the end of my bed. She said my father had been involved in a horrendous car accident, and I was to go and live with another family friend, Mr. and Mrs. Colin Johnson, as Mum had gone with my father to a hospital in Sydney. As an 8-year-old, I didn't understand the gravity of the situation, and certainly didn't comprehend that my father was in a life-threatening condition. He had been driving some people home on a country road late in the evening, after I had gone to bed, when a drunken, speeding driver crossed onto the wrong side of the road, slamming into my father's car. 2 people were instantly killed, and Dad was critically injured. My father didn't return to Barrel for several weeks. My brother and I went to stay with the Johnsons and my sister with the Mackenzies. I didn't see my parents during this time, and none the wiser, enjoyed staying at the Johnsons. I was allowed all the forbidden foods like Cocoa Pops for breakfast, and we could do the unthinkable and watch television in the morning. Eventually, after many operations and blood transfusions, my father came back to Barrel Hospital for another couple of months of healing and rehabilitation, and my mother returned home. So it was back home for us, and back to mundane Weet-Bix, and sadly, no more morning television. Dad was barely mobile on crutches, and he had his jaw wired together, and he could only eat via a straw. As a result, he couldn't speak well, and understanding him was difficult. He obviously couldn't work, and this was in the days before income protection insurance, but the church community gathered around and everyone helped out to see us through. 2 months after the accident, Dad was able to return to work. He had to do so while still on crutches, with wires in his jaw. He was able to operate as soon as he could stand unaided. Random breath testing hadn't been introduced back in the 1970s, and Dad took up the cause to have drink driving penalised harshly. Such was the backlash that he got all sorts of hate mail and threats. As a school project, we were asked to draw posters about the dangers of drink driving. Not that any of us really knew what it meant. I remained puzzled as to why you should be expected to drive and be thirsty. Random breath testing in my home state of New South Wales began trials in 1982. The introduction of RBT was an outstanding success, given the road toll then plummeted by hundreds each year. One evening, we had a knock at the door and a young 19-year-old man who had been drunk and responsible for the crash that night came with his father seeking forgiveness. My mother was in tears and struggled to greet him. She was still greatly upset with the young man. Dad sat down slowly, in obvious pain, placing his crutches beside the chair. The man was broken with guilt, having those lives on his conscience from such a young age. His life was also ruined, but at his own hands. Dad listened to him and offered forgiveness. Forgiveness did not deny his guilt, but it paved the way for reconciliation and healing, so necessary if this young man was to be restored. Dad had a strong Christian faith and followed Christ's example, as he said while dying on the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Christ had forgiven Dad for the wrongs he had done in the past and given him a new, wonderful life. So who was Dad to withhold his forgiveness? Scholar, novelist, and author C.S. Lewis put it like this: "To be a Christian means to forgive the inexcusable, because God has forgiven the inexcusable." Following my dad's forgiveness, I hope the young man found some healing. He later faced court, was sentenced, and spent 9 months in jail for killing two people and nearly killing two others. Dad had more operations for 2 years after the accident and still carries some of the scars. Bits of metal are still in his body, and he has pains in his limbs and joints. He rarely complains. The way my dad conducted himself throughout the ordeal and the grace he showed in forgiving the 19-year-old was a great example to the entire family. No wonder he was such an influence on me. My mother, too, played a large part in moulding me into who I am today. Dad was often away at work, and her strength kept the family together. After his accident, Mum's tenderness and always knowing the right things to say in times of trouble was inspirational. My parents have had, and continue to have, a critical influence on me. David was the only obstetrician in Bowral for 9 years, and he also served the surrounding districts. He worked tirelessly for the benefit of all his patients. The patients always came first. Even on Christmas Day as children, we would have to wait patiently around the Christmas tree before Dad returned from the hospital ward round or from attending some obstetric emergency, and only then could we open our presents. My mother worked hard to keep the household moving, as well as doing a lot of volunteer work in the town, including helping palliative care nurses in the community. At times, we would take children from Department of Community Service homes out for the day to join us on family picnics or stay with us through periods of insecurity in their lives. The kids would often be unruly, but my parents tried to show them a place of stability and love. Dad and Mum supported many missions and charities, and I have fond memories of packing sutures and other medical supplies into boxes on the lounge room floor, ready to ship to Africa. Probably what impacted me most, however, was seeing Dad kneeling beside his bed every morning, reading the Bible aloud with Mum, and then watching them pray together. Despite whatever was going on, every morning at 6:45, this would be the routine. Every day would begin in and around God's Word. Another person who had a significant impact on me is my aunt Valerie Browning. Valerie is an Australian nurse who first went to work in Ethiopia as a young 22-year-old in 1973. She has lived amongst the Afar nomads in northern Ethiopia for more than 40 years. She married an Afar elder in 1988, and together they started their own development organisation to help the Afar. She has worked tirelessly to improve their lives in an area that had close to universal illiteracy when she started, as well as a high child mortality rate. Her large organisation now has more than 750 employees and provides basic healthcare for over a million Afar people. Growing up in Barrel in the 70s and 80s, I rarely saw Valerie because she left to go to Ethiopia when I was three and would return to Australia less than a handful of times until I went to see her in Ethiopia in my mid-20s. I learnt more about her from seeing her on television debating with Andrew Peacock, the then Foreign Minister, about Australia's lack of involvement in Africa, or seeing her on the front page of the Australian Women's Weekly magazine, looking tired in a dusty refugee camp in Sudan. Valerie is one of eight siblings, with my father being the eldest. Most years, the whole family would get together at my grandparents' place in Nelson Bay, on the New South Wales mid-north coast. Valerie was never there. And growing up as a child, I thought that everyone had family members out in the world serving others. I also had an aunt and uncle working on a Christian Missionary Society station in outback South Australia, and other aunts and uncles working in other remote areas serving people less fortunate than themselves. Valerie's mother, my grandmother, and the matriarch of the family, Barbara May Browning, strongly influenced her daughter and the rest of her children. She lived an altruistic life, placing little value on material possessions and always looked to improve the lives of others. If I was feeling down, she seemed to know exactly the right thing to say to lift my spirits, even though she had more than 20 other grandchildren clamoring for her attention. Barbara was the inspiration for our foundation, the Barbara May Foundation, which has been established to fund projects in Africa. She was a great supporter of Valerie's and my work, and even at the age of 83, she travelled to Africa in 1999 to visit her daughter and son-in-law, Ismail, to see their work firsthand. My grandmother passed away in 2004, aged 88. With all this influence, it was not going to be hard for me to find the desire and passion to follow my aunt's footsteps into Africa. Despite Dad's accident, I'm grateful that I had a wonderful childhood running around in the bush, camping with friends, climbing cliffs, finding caves, swimming in rivers and waterholes, and all the other usual rural Australian childhood adventures. It was a childhood of great freedom, walking to school by myself from kindergarten onwards, running home via the local creek and catching little fish, yabbies, and the odd turtle with my friends before coming home. School uniform filthy, much to the dismay of my mother. When I was 14 years old, there was a defining moment in my life for which I will forever be grateful. A group of us were attending the church youth group in Bowral. We were invited to a rally in a church in the nearby village of Hilltop. It was a cold southern highland winter's night, and a group called Youth with a Mission were singing and presenting. Listening to the speaker, I was riveted as he explained that Jesus died for my sins so that I could have a relationship with him. I had always known this growing up in church and Sunday school, but it never really hit home. At the end of the talk, the speaker made a beeline for me and asked if I wanted to give my life to Christ, to which I said yes, and immediately an overwhelming sense of joy and love flooded through my whole being. I sat alone in the minivan on the way home while everyone around me was clowning around. All I could do was thank Christ and dedicate everything I had to following him. It was so liberating. This was not to say that being a Christian has always been like that. There have been times of great doubt, struggling with sin and temptation and wanting to live my life my own way and not Christ's way. But there have been enormous highs as well. Reading God's Word, the Bible, is like God speaking directly to my soul. That night, in the old weatherboard church hall in Hilltop, was my born-again moment. While it is a cliched phrase, it is the best description of what happened, and it changed everything for me from then on. During my early years of high school, I coasted through studies, enjoying more time playing soccer, riding bikes, exploring the bush and being with friends. Some of us would get up very early in the morning, ride our bikes to the river, only in the barrel summer, and swim, before returning home to change and to get to school, only to fall asleep in Mr. Summer's maths class. It was a blessing for me to do well in most subjects at school, but I had the urge to do well in sport rather than pursuing academia. I attended a Catholic school in Bowral, which, while serving local students, also took in boarders. This was good news for me because during year 11 and 12, a very bright, hard-working boy from Brunei, south of the Philippines, came to board. He started to get higher marks than me in pretty well every subject, and a strong determination and competitive instinct within me was stirred. I started to work hard to regain my top position. It didn't work. He claimed one of the highest marks in the state in the HSC, but without his presence, I'm sure I would have still coasted through and not made the grade to get into medicine at the University of Sydney. Perhaps without his driving me, I would never have realised the flame that was sparked within me at Sunday school at the age of 6. But I thankfully did get the mark I needed, and off I went to the University of Sydney. Living in Sydney to attend university was a culture shock for a young boy from what was then a sheltered small country town. I went from Bowral, where most people knew me, to a busy city where I was anonymous. I had only been to Sydney a handful of times before moving there, and only on school excursions to the Opera House or the Australian Museum. It took some time before I found my feet, and the city was never a place I enjoyed. But if I wanted to be a doctor, I needed to be in Sydney. At university, I led Bible study groups and taught Sunday school in a local church, all the while determined to become a missionary doctor. My first glimpse of that life came when I went to Tanzania just at the beginning of the genocide in Rwanda. Chapter 2. Rwandan Genocide. Right in the heart of Africa are two tranquil, beautiful, and verdant countries, Burundi and Rwanda. They are green, lush, and mountainous, and oft described as the Switzerland of Africa. Different tribes from different people groups have been living there since time immemorial. The largest tribal group is the Hutus, a Bantu people group typical of the sub-Saharan people, stocky with wide facial features. The smaller tribe, the Tutsis, are a taller, traditionally cattle-herding people. These two tribal groups have been living side by side for generations, occasionally coming to blows, occasionally living in harmony, but with much intermarrying. During the colonial period, Germany was allocated the areas of Burundi and Rwanda by the Berlin Conference of 1884. the Germans favoured the Tutsis and gave them positions reflecting that. During World War I, the Belgians took the country by force and did what many colonial lords did. They divided and conquered. They exaggerated existing divisions. Artificial borders were drawn up, and artificial names were given to artificial countries. To create division, they even went so far as to measure the width of people's noses to define them as Hutus or Tutsis. The Tutsis were once again favoured, and although a minority, they were placed in positions of responsibility and power over their Hutu countrymen. Tensions, historically always present, started to simmer. In October of 1993, the newly elected Hutu president of Burundi, Melchior Ndadaye, was assassinated by extremist Tutsi army officers. Pressures between Hutus and Tutsis in the region were increasing, and some say that the mass extermination of the Tutsis by the Hutus was being planned for years before that. The assassination of Ndadaye poured fuel on the fire, and it is estimated that by the end of 1993, there were up to 350,000 refugees in western Tanzania, mainly from Burundi, but more were to come.
Then, on April 6, 1994,
in clear skies, on final approach over Rwanda's capital, Kigali, the presidential Dassault Falcon jet was struck by two surface-to-air missiles, causing the plane to erupt in a ball of yellow flames before it crashed violently into the garden of the presidential palace, exploding on impact. On board the plane were three French crew and nine passengers, including the Hutu president, Juvenal Habyarimana. There were no survivors. Just as the assassination of Austria's Archduke Ferdinand on 28th of June 1914 set off a chain of events culminating in one of the deadliest conflicts in history, World War I, the assassination of the Rwandan president was the impetus for one of the bloodiest events Africa has ever been involved in, the Rwandan Genocide. The clash of cultures and the tussle for power between the Tutsis and the Hutus had come to a violent head. Within hours of the attack, the mass slaughter of Tutsis began, resulting in the genocide of hundreds of thousands of people in the following 3 months. One of the first to be killed was Prime Minister Agathe Uwilingiyimana, who was violently and sexually assaulted before she was shot. This was the sort of violence which would become typical across the nation in coming weeks. It was a dreadful time for Rwanda and 100 days of unbridled terror. Overall, 800,000, some estimate the number went beyond a million, Tutsi and Hutu moderates were killed between April and July 1994 by the militia. Thousands of Tutsi women were kidnapped and kept as sex slaves. Using machetes, neighbour slaughtered neighbour, and it was reported that some husbands killed wives fearing retribution if they did not act. It was the most rapid genocide ever recorded and has been compared to the Nazi Holocaust because of the ferocity and cruelty of the brutal attacks. Fearing revenge attacks, 2 million Hutus then fled across the borders to Zaire, now the Democratic Republic of the Congo, or the DRC, Tanzania, and Burundi. In 1993, I had just begun my elective term as a young medical student. Even though I was studying at the University of Sydney, I was able to undertake some of my in-hospital training overseas. Many people took the chance to do some research in Australia. Others worked in England or America, while a few of us chose more remote locations. Recalling the Tanzanian hospital I had heard about as a six-year-old at Sunday school from an Australian missionary nurse, I decided to go to the same place. The instability in the region was rising, and news had reached Australia of the hundreds of thousands of refugees in western Tanzania, just where I was off to. At that time, back in 1993, there were no phones, let alone internet, at the hospital, and electrical blackouts were common. Letters to arrange my work at the Tanzanian hospital took around 6 weeks at best to return, sometimes 12 weeks. We heard little and assumed all was well for me to go. Boarding my flight at Mascot Airport in Sydney, I was excited about what lay ahead. I arrived at the hospital by a circuitous route, landing in Harare, Zimbabwe, near where my grandfather had worked on a tobacco farm in the 1930s. Using buses, trains and planes, I travelled with a friend, Patrick Rawstorn, who was a keen athlete and had connections with some of the Zimbabwean national athletics team. We travelled around Zimbabwe, getting mugged in Bulawayo, staying with Zimbabwean athletes in their villages, running with them, or rather, I sprinted and they cantered along. We eventually found our way to Zanzibar, and after farewelling Patrick, I travelled alone towards Mgwanza Hospital in far northwestern Tanzania. My last stop before reaching Mgwanza was in the lakeside town of Mwanza, on the shore of Lake Victoria. I stayed at a mission compound, went to church on Sunday, and was invited to speak at the primary school the next day. The following day, I flew to Mgwanza in a small six-seater Cessna over the sprawling blue Lake Victoria, then across green valleys, landing on a rough grass airstrip on the side of a wooded hill. It was a weekly passenger flight, which also brought all the mail in. The missionaries and their children rushed to the airstrip where they heard the plane approaching, hoping that some letters might have come. This was the only way they received news from home, whether that be England or Australia. As it happened, the hospital was right where the borders of Burundi, Rwanda, and Tanzania meet. Down the valley from the hospital ran the Kagera River on its way out of Rwanda to flow into Africa's largest lake, Lake Victoria. Lake Victoria is located in three countries, Tanzania, Uganda, and Kenya. Some say that the Kagera River is actually the true source of the Nile as it drains into the lake from its beginnings, nestled far away in the mountains of Rwanda. From the house I stayed in, you looked across the river straight into Rwanda and its mountains. On some really clear days, you could see right across Rwanda to the smoking volcanoes of the DRC in the distance. Most evenings, I would sit on the front porch of the house I shared with a missionary couple from Australia. The sun sets quickly in the tropics. It doesn't take its time to slide beneath the horizon as it does in the temperate zones further away from the equator. Instead, it just sinks straight down rather unceremoniously, like a bright orange ball, and the sky fades rapidly to black. As it did so, the noises, sights and smells from the valley below would change. I heard the noise of cows lowing as they were driven to shelter, goats bleating, children playing, men occasionally shouting, and women calling the names of their children. The voices and sounds travelled vast distances. None of these animals or people could be seen, but only heard against the reddening land and dimming light as the sun set and the stars started to come out one by one. Fires were lit, and rising through the roofs of the thatched mud huts, the smoke hovered around the tops of the banana groves. Darkness would come, and an eerie quiet would settle. A few doors up from the house where I stayed was one of the original colonial-style houses with thick walls made of whitewashed mud. Its smooth concrete floors were painted a deep red and were chipped and cracking in places to reveal the grey, loose, poorly prepared cement beneath. These were universal features of many houses I would stay in and later call home. Around this particular house was a large, unfenced yard full of purple and red bougainvillea and a great veranda from which to watch the sunset. An Australian missionary nurse lived there by herself, and we would regularly have lunch there together. I thought I could be very happy living in such a house. In many ways, life was much simpler, more basic, and more enjoyable than life back in Australia. My favourite time of day was after work in the early evening, when I'd go for a run down into the valley, through the villages, hear the children laughing, and then have them chase after me. From there, it was back up the hill to the hospital again. I'd join in games of soccer with the children, using rolled-up rags tied together to make a ball and playing on uneven dirt ground with bare feet. Their parents would ask me into their huts and try to teach me Swahili. It was a useless pursuit, and they just laughed. Sometimes they'd catch a chicken in the yard and kill it, cook it, and we'd eat it. The meat was that tough and that scrawny, it would nearly break my teeth. On the weekend, we'd go food shopping in the market across a small valley in the other direction in the town called Nagara. The market was full of sights and smells. People carried food wrapped in banana leaves on their heads, chickens in small cages made of thin green branches woven together, eggs, and a limited variety of fruit and vegetables, but in great quantities. There was no plastic and no waste. The food was wrapped in banana leaves, and you would carry it home in a basket made of woven grass. Everything was biodegradable. Once, when walking the few kilometres back from the market, I got stuck in a monsoonal downpour. But I had one of those large banana leaves, which doubled as an umbrella. Unfortunately, things have changed now. Plastic bags and plastic water bottles have been introduced in the name of commerce and convenience. They litter the countryside, caught in bushes and trees in their millions. They will be present well after the trees have died. It really has been an upsetting step backwards. The tranquility of the setting where I was staying in Mugwanza was in stark contrast to what was happening in the killing fields in nearby Rwanda and Burundi. This was the same land that I looked over from the peaceful veranda each night, watching the sunset in a blood-red sky. When I arrived in Mugwanza in Tanzania in 1993, I was just a fresh-faced 23-year-old man, having experienced little outside of Bowral and the University of Sydney. That was all about to change as I witnessed some of the 20,000 refugees fleeing from Burundi and Rwanda arriving in the areas around the hospital. I began each day in the hospital with eyes wide open, struggling to take in all the differences to home, but thrilled about making a difference with so little. One of my first experiences in an African hospital was seeing a young man who had been savagely bitten by a hippopotamus after rowing his boat in the Kagera River on the Rwanda-Tanzania border. When he got too close to the giant herbivore, it became startled, and with an enraged flick of its head, the aggressive hippo overturned the man's boat. The hippo crushed his leg with its massive jaws, splintering the bones of his leg into 1,000 pieces. There was no option but to amputate. I've only come across one other hippo bite and a smattering of other injuries from wild animals, but the next patient was more typical of what I would encounter during the rest of my career. He was a newborn who was floppy and with no discernible breath or heartbeat. The mother had been in labour for too long in the village before she came to the hospital, and the doctors hurriedly performed a caesarean, but they were too late. The baby's heart had stopped. As I searched my mind to work out what to do for this newborn, I knew that in Australia I would be able to press a button on the wall and an army of paediatricians, intensivists, midwives and others would come to my aid,
racing through the door and nudging me out of the way
to take over with highly advanced procedures to save the newborn. Not in Tanzania. This baby had one chance besides me, an inexperienced med student still at university, and it was the nurse assisting me. "Nurse, quickly pass me the resus bag," I said, as I reached for perhaps the most vital piece of resuscitation equipment needed in this sort of situation. "Doctor, it does not work properly," the brown-eyed Tanzanian midwife replied in slow, broken English. The small, black resuscitation bag had a massive hole gouged into its side, rendering it completely useless. The nurse did not appear surprised. Perhaps this was the norm for this part of the world, I thought. My stress levels rose. Time was of the essence before this baby had irreparable brain damage. The race was well and truly on. "Quick, nurse, place 2 fingers in the middle of the baby's chest, just like this, below the nipples," I urged, as we started CPR. The nurse did her job beautifully, and didn't need me to instruct her at all. With the resuscitation bag rendered ineffective, I resorted to old-style CPR with mouth-to-mouth and nose resuscitation. My dry mouth was covering the baby's nose and mouth as I puffed air into his lungs. The taste and smell of amniotic fluid and vernix, the fluid and waxy covering of babies inside the womb, was still present and made me gag. The nurse was doing an admirable job pushing the oxygenated blood around the body.
We tried injecting the baby with life-saving adrenaline straight into his heart,
and we were doing everything possible with what was available. But after 30 or 40 minutes or so, we knew that our efforts were futile. The baby boy was dead. Feeling soiled, sweaty, and defeated after our intense battle to save this little boy, we trudged slowly towards the mother. She had been in labour for too long in the village. She had needed a caesarean much earlier. My joyful job as the trainee was usually to receive the baby and hand him to the mother for bonding. Now, under completely different circumstances, I handed the lifeless, limp form back to the mother, who was now in the recovery area, a small, poorly lit and ill-equipped spot outside theatre. She held her child with empty, glassy eyes and stared into mine. No anger, nothing said, just a look of complete helplessness and loss. I feared that I would see many more eyes like this in the days and years ahead if I decided to make this my career. The hospital missionaries told me of a Red Cross worker who was living in the hospital compound. They thought I should meet her and see if she needed anything at the camps housing refugees who had fled Burundi. I went to her house straight away and knocked on the door. A very tired and, if it's not too unkind to say, dishevelled-looking Scottish lady called Sheila answered the door, hunched over slightly, looking older than her early 30-something years. She wore rough leather sandals and a long, faded floral dress over a white T-shirt. She kindly invited me in with a smile and a sparkle in her eyes that made me think she might have been short of some company. She had taken up residence in the hospital as she mobilised the Red Cross to help establish some refugee camps for people who had arrived across the border. These were the ones who were still alive. Later, there were times when the dead came floating down the Kagara River out of Rwanda. "Are you the only organisation working in the camps?" I asked, as she boiled an old tin kettle over a crude gas burner making some tea. "More or less," she said, stirring the tea. "We did see the UN in their vehicles at some stage, walking about with their clipboards, but they haven't been seen since." Sheila had been working for the Red Cross around the world in some of the worst humanitarian disasters of the time. She didn't have a lot to say about the UN, but what she did say was negative. "They'll turn up again after all the hard work has been done and claim it all as their own," she said, sipping her tea. The tea was pretty awful. "Can you come to the camps and help?" Sheila asked. I jumped at the chance. "When?" "I'm leaving tomorrow morning, early. The camp I want to go to is about an hour away, and its water source is no good, and people are getting sick. We've found a doctor amongst the refugees, and he's running a clinic. You can help him," she said in a Scottish brogue. The next morning, we headed off in a beaten-up old diesel Land Rover Discovery, bumping over red dirt roads, driving down into potholes rather than over them. The camp was a throng of people milling around Red Cross tents, which were set up everywhere. Some food distribution had just started when I arrived. Heavy white sacks of grain were being handed down off a truck and divided amongst people. They had been given cooking implements and were going about their lives as best as they could. After talking to the people distributing the grain, Sheila looked at me. "Right, let's look at this water supply." And off she paced. I struggled to keep up with her. Sheila was racing away, hunched over, still in her faded floral dress over her white T-shirt. I watched where her worn leather sandals were leading me, across the thin, red soil paths with thick, high lime green vegetation on either side. Within 10 minutes, We were at a stream where children bathed and women washed clothes upstream, while people gathered water for drinking and cooking downstream.
"This won't do," Sheila shrieked. "You need to be gathering water upstream and washing downstream. Even better,
take the water in buckets
and wash far away from the stream." This sort of activity was a recipe for more dysentery, diarrhea, or even cholera. Sheila was driven and passionate and could certainly get things done. Feeling totally out of my depth in this new environment, I was led to the clinic. The clinic was a bench outside with a tent behind. We had a supply of a few basic medicines and some IV fluids. It was still early, but there was already a long line of people to be seen. The Burundian doctor looked at me with amusement. I could hear his mind tick over. A fresh young medical student from Australia. What could he do? Medical training in the West is thorough regarding knowledge, but very slow regarding gaining clinical experience. At the time, medical students around Africa certainly had a lot more responsibility and were doing procedures in hospitals. Even first-year-out doctors in Africa were expected to perform major operations. Not so in Australia. We could take a history and an examination, and that was about it. With the help of a translator, I gradually worked through a fair quota of patients, and I'm sure I made quite a botch of things, but there wasn't much I could do. I had a handful of antibiotics, some paracetamol, IV fluids, and first aid. It wasn't hard to look like I knew what I was doing with so little equipment, and common sense dictated much of what needed to be done. There were a few severely dehydrated people from the dysentery outbreak who needed to be taken back to the hospital. There we could start the IV fluids and send them back to the camp after they recovered. Dysentery, so easily cured in the West, took a terrible toll on the tightly packed refugees in overcrowded camps. In one car trip back from the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.